Today is December the 26th, 2018. It's the day after Christmas. Welcome to the Personal Computer Show. I'm Hank Key and my colleague is Joe King. Our website is pcradioshow.org. We can be heard each Wednesday at 6 p.m. Eastern Time on prn.fm, on the Internet, as well as on various podcast hosting sites. WBAI has, for various reasons, not been able to be financially self-supporting. It has to broaden to a larger listening audience to continue operation. The management has decided to do a major overhaul of the program schedule. Listeners and viewers are increasingly using the Internet to receive their media content on demand instead of being tethered to a fixed schedule. WBAI has revamped the program schedule to begin January the 7th, 2019. The Personal Computer Show is not part of that mix. Although we will not be part of the new program schedule, the Personal Computer Show will continue to be available on the Internet. The program will continue to be available on prn.fm, on the Internet as it is presently scheduled on Wednesday, 6 p.m. Eastern Time. Podcasts of the programs will continue to be available from prn.fm or the major podcast hosting sites, as well as our website, pcradioshow.org. In this new format, we can continue to be heard regularly every week. The on-air radio program broadcasting from WBAI-FM 99.5 New York has been subjected to so many unannounced preemptions that many listeners don't know if we're on or if we're off. Indeed, we will go back to our roots in which you, the listening audience, are part of the program. WBAI has not had a telephone system for our listeners to call since we moved out of the Wall Street studios in 2012 in the aftermath of Hurricane Sandy. If you send us your question or a brief description of what you want to discuss via email, along with your telephone number and a convenient time at which we can reach you, we will call you and record the call for broadcast during the show. If you have any questions or comments for us, just send us an email address to hank@pcradioshow.org. Just remember, there's no such thing as a stupid question. The conversation will be recorded to be part of the show, but if you're bashful or shy or just want to remain anonymous, it's no problem. We'll just use the context of what is on your mind and attribute it to a query received in our mailbag, without identifying who wrote us the email. And if you prefer, we do have associates on the air with their feature segments. If you want them to answer your question, we can make arrangements for that too. You, the listening audience, are not the product for the Personal Computer Show, but are an integral part of the show. Just as personal computing has morphed into different supporting platforms since we first broadcast live in 1983, broadcasting on local radio stations has morphed into worldwide podcasting. We hope you will join us in this exciting new adventure and format. Send email to me, hank@pcradioshow.org, and let's talk about your computing problems or, better yet, whatever questions or opinions you have about computing. For over 35 years, we were a call-in talkback show. Your feedback enabled us to be in tune and relevant with the changes in technology. WBAI has not had telephone service in the studio for the past 3 years, and this has constrained the program from engaging the listening audience. Although WBAI will return to a more normal operation soon, it is controlling the program distribution onto other media formats. With the changes, we will return to our roots. You, the listening audience, have been the success of the program. The potential listening audience on the Internet is quite broad, and with the ability to control our format and distribution, we will better serve you. Although we are parting company with WBAI, Joe King and I have had a great association on WBAI. We ask you to continue to support the station in its new format. WBAI present alternative programming that is not normally covered by the mainstream media. New York City has one of the most diverse communities encompassing different ethnic cultures. We will start to use different formats to engage you, the listeners. Telephone call-ins with your questions and your opinions will start soon, and we'll let you know what the telephone number is next week. We will also call you to record your question and opinions at a time convenient for you for broadcast. You can send us pre-recording of your question and opinions in which we will respond to you on the air. If you are shy, we can take your questions and opinions via email and address them on the broadcast. Listen to the program via telephone if you don't have access to the internet. And again, we will be posting this information on our website, pcradioshow.org, and we'll be announcing those phone numbers next week. Do you know who has your personal data? Let me ask the question differently. Do you know who's using your personal data besides Facebook and Google? Apple has confirmed some iPad Pros shipped are slightly bent, but says it's normal. Apple has said that some of its 2018 iPad Pros are shipping with a very slight bend in the aluminum chassis. According to the company, this is a side effect of the device's manufacturing process and shouldn't worsen over time or negatively affect the iPad performance in any practical way. Apple does not consider it to be a defect. Nope, it's not a performance defect, but it is a cosmetic defect. The bend is a result of a cooling process involving the iPad Pro's metal and plastic components during manufacturing. Both sizes of the new iPad Pro can exhibit it. The iPad Pro ranges in price from $799 for the base 11-inch model up to $1,899 for a fully loaded 12.9-inch device with 1 terabyte of storage and LTE connectivity. For the price it is charging, why should any consumer accept a product from Apple that is less than perfection in looks? The response comes after some customers on social media believe it happened gradually over the course of normal everyday use, or after transporting the iPad Pro in a backpack. Apple is now saying that, in some cases, the latter is true. It's an issue that seems to be more pronounced on the LTE model, as there's a plastic strip that breaks up the iPad flat aluminum sides. It's where the antenna line divides the two sections of metal that some users have noticed a bend. Apple did not say the perceived flaw is strictly limited to the cellular iPad Pro. However, some buyers of the Wi-Fi model also claim to have encountered it, even if only cosmetic. The issue is out of character for Apple, which has based its reputation in manufacturing devices with a best-in-industry fit and finish. Those who are annoyed by the bend shouldn't have any trouble exchanging it or returning their iPad Pro at the Apple Store or other retailers within the 14-day return window. But it's not clear if swaps would be permitted outside that policy. Apple says that concerns over the iPad Pro structural rigidity are unfounded and that it stands by the product. Apple's reputation has been fit and finish for products with a very high profit margin. Why should anyone accept cosmetic defects in manufacture? To round out the end of the year, from the Tech Corner, I'm going to be talking about hardware and if you're having a problem with it. What do you do when your computer seems to run with a mind of its own? What to do when your system cannot start up cleanly or it just doesn't turn on? And preventive maintenance of computing equipment. There is a clear cell phone cancer link, but FDA is downplaying it. And finally, I'm going to cover wireless printers are vulnerable when connected to port 9100. What do you do when your computer seems to be running with a mind of its own? There are apps when installed that refuses to be uninstalled. There are instances when your Windows operating system appears to be running out of control. You run the registry cleaner. You clean up extraneous files with Crap Cleaner or C Cleaner. It didn't help at all. Your first step is to do a system restore to a date prior to the date of the problem. If you did not have the saving the system restore point set on, well, then you've had a teachable lesson. In most cases, it does solve the problem. But what if that doesn't fix the problem? What's next? You go to Plan B. Use the system file checker tool that's built into Windows to repair missing or corrupted system files. If some Windows functions aren't working or Windows crashes, use the system file checker to scan Windows and restore your files. How do you do it? Well, get into command mode in administrative mode and then run system file checker That's SFC. That's SFC space forward slash scan now. I'll repeat that again. SFC space forward slash scan now, and then you press enter. This will take a while to run. Just be patient. Go out and have a mug of coffee. Wait a minute, change that to a carafe of coffee. I've run SFC on computers and it either returns a report of no problems or it reports it has found problems and fixed them. In rare cases, it does report corruption found and not able to do a fix. When that happens, you go to Plan C. Microsoft has a Fix-It utility. Just do a search in the URL typing the following: Microsoft space fix space it space tool. I'll repeat it again. It's Microsoft Fix-It tool. If you're not on the computer that has the problem, just save the troubleshooter to a flash drive and then run it on the computer that has the problem. What does this fix? Corrupted registry keys on a 64-bit operating system. Corrupted register keys that control the update data. Problems that prevent new programs from being installed. Problems that prevent existing programs from being completely uninstalled or updated. Problems that block you from uninstalling a program through add or remove programs or programs and features in the control panel. If the problem persists, then go to Plan D, which is to rebuild the operating system. By the way, you did do backup on your data on a regular basis, right? Let's say you need to reinstall the Windows operating system. When you purchase a system today, the distribution version of the operating system is stored in hidden partitions. If it was a Windows 10 operating system on the computer, a factory reset will get you back to the release version of Windows 10 at the time of purchase. After the reinstallation over time, your computer will be upgraded to the latest version of Windows 10. You will need only to reinstall the applications originally on the system with the associated data from your backup files. But what if the factory reset gets you back to Windows 7, which you had subsequently upgraded to Windows 10? The free upgrade of Windows 7 to 10 from Microsoft terminated at the end of 2016. There were Microsoft Windows build releases, version 1507, 1511, and 1607, prior to the beginning of 2017. If you have downloaded any one of those releases, you can still do a free upgrade of Windows 7 to Windows 10. These Windows 10 build versions are still available from Microsoft, but at a price. They are available from third-party sources, free. One site is windowsiso.net. That's windowsiso.net. Even if you don't need it today, but the hidden partitions is Windows 7, download the appropriate build release before Microsoft formally requests third-party sites to cease distribution. The downloaded file is in ISO or image format. When you open the ISO file in Windows 10, you have opened a subdirectory of all the files in the Windows 10 distribution. Copy these files onto a USB drive and run the setup.exe to upgrade your Windows 7 to 10. You can run a clean install instead of the upgrade if you have the Windows 7 product code. What if you had mislaid the product 7 product code? What do you do then? And you don't have it readily available. Simple. Download the program Magical Jelly Bean, and when you run that program, it will tell you what the product code is, but do this before you begin any upgrade or reinstallation of Windows 10. What do you do when your system can't start up cleanly or it just doesn't turn on? Last Wednesday, I had finished editing the weekly broadcast at about 2 a.m. in the morning, and there was a message that Windows Update would start up. I opted to let the Windows Update proceed as I was tired. I did not back up the completed broadcast. I just went to sleep. I woke up at about 8 a.m. and got back onto the system. The system booted up asking for the Windows password. I had none to begin with. Only option was entering the password or click on I forgot password. Each time I clicked on I forgot password, I received a message to enter password or click on I forgot password. Each time I turned off the machine and restarted, the same message popped up on the screen. I went into action on Plan A to get the system up and running. I tried booting up with warm restart on a number of occasions to no avail, and now it was time to go into Plan B. I pulled out the Windows installation distribution to do an initial system boot, and I selected the Windows System Restore option. There were about 9 different points of options available for me to use. I went through each restore attempt, and it failed. I wasn't flustered yet. I just moved on to Plan C. Next option was to restore to the previous build. Unfortunately, the previous build was corrupted. Well, I next tried to do a factory reset without losing data. Murphy's Law was in effect. It was not possible to do a clean system install without erasing the data. I had just spent 3 hours trying to retrieve the data, and the clock was ticking. So, rather than spend any more time on it, I called Microsoft support. The technician suggested all the steps I had gone through. His final recommendation was just do a factory reset, forget about any data being available. According to him, there was no other option. But in the back of my mind, I always had a last resort. I removed the hard disk drive from the notebook in question and installed the hard drive into an external enclosure. This in turn was connected to another system I had available. This enabled me to recover last week's broadcast. When you are removing any component part from a notebook, just remember to disconnect the AC power and remove the battery from the unit first. What lessons were to be learned? Well, turn off the automatic Windows update and do the manual update, and don't feel bad that you're not doing an update immediately as soon as it's released. In fact, I would hold off until there's no other complaints on it. There had been a lot of complaints about the Windows 10 update, release 18.07. Make sure your system restore for the drive C is on, because that's where your operating system is. And in my case, I had on hand a spare external enclosure, and if you don't have one, you can get one for about $10 at Micro Center so that you can move the hard or solid-state drive into that enclosure. Also have available a Windows 10 distribution media available. If you don't have it, there is a website you can go to. It's called windowsiso.net. That's one word, windowsiso.net. They have many of the 7, 8, 8.1, and 10 distributions of Windows available. In my case, for Windows 10, I keep the releases that were in 2015 and 2016. I don't necessarily have to worry about keeping up to date on 17 and 18. Reasons are very simple. If you install Windows from 2015 or 2016, it would do a free upgrade of 7 or 8.1 to Windows 10. If you use the later ones, it won't. Download the hardware maintenance manual so you know how to open up the unit to remove the hard disk drive. If you do not or are unable to get a clean boot, try restore to a prior system restore point that was working. If unsuccessful, try all other restore points. If that is unsuccessful, then restore to a prior build. If that is unsuccessful, well, you know the drill. What if you're still running with Windows 7? Is the recovery process any different? Yes, there are some slight differences. The recovery program disk for Windows 7 has to be created from Windows 7 itself. If you had not created the recovery media for Windows 7, do so now. What if your system is down and you cannot create this disk? Well, find a buddy who's still running Windows 7. What if you are like most computer users, the Windows 7 installation disk is somewhere in a safe place? It is so safe you don't remember where you put it. On later Windows 7 purchase units, the Windows 7 operating system distribution is in a hidden partition. In earlier units, the distribution was supplied on separate media. If you misplace your Windows 7 installation disk, which may be the actual disk that came with your PC or a retail Windows 7 installed disk that you bought separately, you can still get a copy of the Windows 7 installation distribution from Microsoft at a modest cost if you provide them with your system product code. Alternatively, you can get a free copy from WindowsISO.net, or that's WindowsISO.net, without providing the product code. The version of Windows 7 is also important, as product keys will only work with certain versions of Windows. Simply launch the Start menu, right-click on Computer, and select Properties from the context menu. Of course, you can also look on the box or documentation that came with the Windows 7 purchase. If you provide Microsoft with just the product code, Microsoft will figure out what version of Windows 7 is needed based on the product key and give you links to download that version. If you don't have your product key, run the utility from magicaljellybean.com to get the info. The product code label for Windows 7 is affixed also on your system unit. It may have faded or fallen off. You can still find the product key by downloading and running the utility from magicaljellybean.com. The only other difference from the Windows 10 recovery is you need to also download a copy of the Windows 10 installation distribution. This will enable you to still upgrade Windows 7 to 10 for free if the build is 2015 or 2016. The later copies of Windows 10 will upgrade 7 to 10 only if the image of the Windows 10 upgrade is on the disk. Like many Windows 7 users, you may want to replace the hard disk drive with a solid-state drive, giving you a performance boost as well as more time to upgrade to Windows 10. We tell listeners that not all information on the internet is accurate. For me, if there's any question about a news item or statement, I try to get it verified from more than one source. But what do you do when there's a conflict of information with a research study in which two U.S. government agencies are at odds with each other? One says there's a clear cell phone cancer link, and that is based on a recent study by the National Toxicology Program under the National Institute of Health, showing clear evidence, at least what they say, of a causal link between cancer and exposure to wireless cell phone signals. These are results from a $30 million NTP study demonstrating that cell phone radiation caused Schwann cells cancers of the heart and brain, gliomas in rats, as well as DNA damaged in the brain. That's big news. In the National Institute of Health news release, NTP senior scientists said, "We believe that the link between radio frequency radiation and tumors in male rats is real, and the external experts agree." But amazingly, the FDA, which is the Food and Drug Administration, says it disagrees with this carefully conducted peer review study finding of clear evidence of really ill effects. According to the director of the FDA Center for Devices and Radiological Health, these findings should not be applied to human cell phone usage. They add that we believe the existing safety limits for cell phones remain acceptable for protecting the public health. While expressing this opinion, Dr. Shurin of the FDA neglects to note that the International Agency for Research Center on Cancer, a part of the World Health Organization, classifies radio frequency radiation from wireless devices as a possible human carcinogen based largely on findings of increased risk of gliomas and Schwann cell tumors in the brain near the ear in humans after long-term use of cell phones. Thus, the same tumor types are elevated in both animals and humans are exposed to cell phone radiation. The FDA's position is quite unusual because it was this agency that nominated cell phone radiation emitted from wireless communication devices to the NTP for studies in experimental animals so as to provide the basis to assess the risk to human health. At that time, the FDA reasoned that existing exposure guidelines are based on protection from acute injury from thermal effects of radio frequency radiation exposure and may not be protective against any non-thermal effects of chronic exposure. By adopting this new position and ignoring the NTP's results, the FDA is clearly shirking its responsibility of assessing the impact on human health of radio frequency radiation. Simply claiming that conclusions about human risk cannot be drawn from animal studies runs counter to standard practices of evaluating human cancer risk by public health agencies. The NTP studies were conducted to test a widely held assumption that cell phone radio frequency radiation could not cause cancer or other adverse health effects because this type of radiation did not have sufficient energy to break chemical bonds. The NTP findings that cell phone radiation caused cancer in the heart and brain, DNA damage in brain cell, heart muscle disease, and reduced birth weights clearly demonstrate that the assumption that non-ionizing radiation cannot cause cancer or other health effects is wrong. This study by the National Health Institute runs counter to the Food and Drug Administration. And what does the public do when there is a difference in the findings or interpretation or an analysis of the information itself? For me, I would probably say I would err on the safety side and say, yes, there may be a potential problem with radio frequency radiation. And I would be more careful in the use of cell phones to make sure that it is not placed close to the ear. An important lesson that should be learned from the NTP studies is that we can no longer assume that any current or future wireless technology, including 5G, is safe without adequate testing. Preventive hardware maintenance of computing equipment. We've been inoculated in the media about the importance of what we eat and drink. The food we ingest has a direct effect on our physical health. Similarly, the care and preventive maintenance of the computing hardware we use will operate more efficiently and we will be able to lengthen the product life cycle of the hardware. With personal computing, there is the hardware maintenance and the software maintenance of a computer system. Preventive maintenance refers to regular, routine maintenance to help keep equipment up and running, preventing any unplanned downtime and expensive costs from unanticipated equipment failure. Include hardware preventive maintenance as a procedure whenever you change the clock in the spring from standard time to daylight time, and in the fall from daylight time to standard time. Computers these days are so reliable in general that we pretty much just ignore the question of whether the surrounding environment is one in which the computer can and should operate. Especially when talking about an office environment, we usually just assume that if we're okay to be in the room, then the computer is probably fine as well. That's not a terrible assumption to start with, but there are some exceptions. If you want your equipment to last a long time and perform well, then taking environmental factors into consideration is actually something you should do. The hardware maintenance of the equipment is to run the system CPU within the range specified by the manufacturer. In general, the internal elements of the CPU has an outer operating limit of 35 to 80 degrees Celsius or 95 to 176 degrees Fahrenheit. What's the best CPU temperature? Don't let your CPU run too hot. The CPU is the processor inside your computer that's responsible for most of the day-to-day number crunching. In short, it's the part that does most of the work to make Windows and applications run. You should consider the operating range of 45 to 70 degrees Celsius or 113 to 158 degrees Fahrenheit, the absolute minimum and maximum for long periods of operation. When it senses the extreme temperatures, the CPU will shut down to prevent any damage. This is temperature operating inside the CPU and not outside of the CPU casing. You have other electronics that are affected by temperature extremes, such as memory. Back in the 1980s, when I operated a bulletin board network, I located the equipment in a spare room where there was no heat or air conditioning. The system froze up when the room temperature dropped below 40 degrees Fahrenheit. Most people will not have to worry about cold temperatures when operating the computer, but heat is a common problem in the operation of a computer system. Before the CPU shuts down, it will run slower and slower and slower. You may wonder why, when you are running the system in a room that is comfortable in temperature, that this can happen. The fan dispersing the heat inside the system unit may not be functioning properly. Most users do not realize dust builds up inside a desktop system unit as well as inside a notebook. Some are running tower systems. To not clutter desktop space, many opt to place the unit at floor level. This placement attracts more dust at this level than the desktop. Another factor are those who have pets at home. Pet hair accumulation around the fan will cause the fan to rotate at much lower RPM and in effect not be able to cool the CPU unit. Use a vacuum carefully to suck out dirt and debris or blow out the dust with a can of compressed air. If you're using compressed air, try not to blow the dust back inside the system unit. If you are able to open the desktop system unit or open the notebook to access the inside, the dust cleaning would be a simple task. The placement of a system unit should have spacing where the fan can blow out. Backing it against the wall would inhibit the fan to be effective. With desktop units, you also have connecting cables. Make sure they are not bent to a point where it's not making good contact with the connecting ports. The ideal temperature is as cool as possible, which usually means room temperature. Since a hot running CPU could cause problems ranging from unwanted system crashes to physical damage to the process itself, you can keep it cool by controlling fan speeds. Another item you should check periodically is a surge protector. The surge protector protects against sudden electrical spikes. When it happens, it will render the surge protector to be useless unless the surge protector can be reset. If you see the light blinking on a surge protector, it means it's time for replacement or you need to do a reset on the surge protector. If you live in a city like New York where there is rolling brownouts during the summer to prevent a total power shutdown, it is recommended you connect your equipment to a UPS battery backup unit. Prices have fallen sharply for this equipment. Units are available for less than $40, which is not that much more than a surge protector with reset feature. A brownout is an intentional or unintentional drop in voltage in an electrical power supply system. Intentional brownouts are used for load reduction in emergency. The reductions last for minutes or hours. The irregular power supply during the brownout can ruin your computer and other electronic devices. Electronics are created to operate at specific voltages, so any fluctuations in power, both up and down, can damage them. A UPS with voltage regulation can prevent any damage to equipment. Most modern CPUs, including AMD, have a protection feature that automatically shuts them down if they get too hot, so that actual damage is unlikely. You can check the specifications of your particular CPU, which details the maximum operating temperatures for many processors. How does one check CPU temperature? Download the program HWinfo by doing a search using the following syntax. Download space HWinfo. That's download space HWinfo. This program is free and it does very detailed hardware monitoring. It will monitor the CPU temperature, speed of the fan, and the life of the battery in the notebook. Temperature is very easy to dismiss because most of us don't think about it when it comes to computers. We just assume it doesn't matter when in fact it does. As long as you know when and when not to operate a computer based on temperature, you should be, well, A-OK. Also bear in mind that all computer hardware and laptops has specifications that state minimum and maximum operating temperatures, and they're usually 100% accurate, and it needs to be observed. Wireless printers are vulnerable when connected to port 9100. We know what Area 51 is, but what is connecting port 9100? When you connect a printer with a printer cable to a computer, the maximum distance is 5 meters, or about 16 plus feet, when connected through a USB 2.0 port. If you are connecting through a USB 3.0 port, the maximum length of the cable cannot exceed 3 meters or just under 10 feet. This direct connect of the printer limits its use to a single user. What evolved after that was connecting more than one user to share the printer. To enable multiple users to share the same printer, print servers were added to the network to enable all network users to access the network printer. Nowadays, print server adapters are available for under $20 to make any printer into a network printer. Many modern-day printers are now available for wireless connection. Now you can print to the wireless printer from your tablet or your smartphone. The typical user network today has default settings to include the identity of their SSID to be visible. Check the Port tab in the Printer Properties. The default setting of 9100 in the Printer tab becomes a vulnerability for attackers. It is also worth mentioning that many new printers have a built-in wireless access point, unencrypted by default, to allow easy printing. An attacker can connect to it while connecting to a printer through Wi-Fi. It does require the attacker to stay physically close to the device, and it may be feasible to perform the attack from outside the targeted location depending on the signal strength. It must be noted that in many educational institutions, it is common even today to assign a public IP address to all network devices, including printers. Raw printing is what we define as the process of making a connection to port 9100, a functionality which was originally introduced by HP in the early 90s using separate hardware modules. It is a default method used by Windows printing architecture to communicate with network printers, as it is considered as the simplest, fastest, and generally the most reliable network protocol used for printers. Raw port 9100 printing is not a printing protocol by itself. Instead, all data sent is directly processed by the printing device, just like a parallel connection over TCP/IP. Such a bidirectional channel is not only perfect for debugging, but gives us direct access to results. Therefore, raw port 9100 printing, which is supported by almost any network printer, is used as a channel for security analysis. Attacking intranet printers, however, may also be attractive to an insider. Department managers payroll. The only thing people can and should do is close these ports, because this isn't a vulnerability. It's just that these protocols don't have the options for authentication. A hacker said that he crafted a list of over 800,000 vulnerable printers, but he only targeted 50,000 in order to test if this would actually work. They said that they witnessed some errors, but that they believe around 48,000 of those printers were affected. In this case, the hacker appears not to have any malicious intent, which is the good news. They claim that motivation is to mainly warn people about the dangers of leaving their network ports open on the internet. The bad news is, the hackers also say that the attacks was easy to execute, the script they wrote is extremely short, and this entire process could have grave consequences. It can also be used to physically damage printers. At the minimum, it can cause losses in ink and paper. But port 9100 is not just limited to printers. It can also include baby monitors, and as more and more gadgets are connected to the internet, as you know, in the Internet of Things, there are far greater opportunities for bad actors to try to break into them. There's a simple and evergreen lesson in all of these incidents. Make sure your devices aren't exposed on the open internet. Marty Winston is going to end up the year by forecasting where he sees tech heading in 2019.
Watching, I taste the past. I touch the future. I predict the next year will be called. Wait, it's coming to me. The vision is forming. I see numbers. I hear a countdown. 20, 19, recalculating. Hey, that wasn't my crystal ball. I crossed my magic 8-ball with my in-dash navigator and threw in a Galena chip from my old crystal set. But all I ever get is the kind of gibberish you just heard, so let's try something else. There are only a few things you have to know to predict what the technology of the near future will include. You have to know where the boom markets are, or where investors believe they'll be, because that lets you identify where major money is being spent on development. Today, that's on self-driving cars, on drones, on smartphones, on remarkably sophisticated but tiny sensors, on video surveillance cameras, on very long footprint mobile coverage, and on significantly faster networking. Did you write all that down? You also have to know which technologies most need to be or are most likely to get improved for those major categories to become available in smaller, better, cheaper chunks, because those can adapt into building blocks for other applications. Today, those technologies include lighting, LIDAR, radar, gas sensing, artificially intelligent image sensing, environmental sensing, and backscatter imaging. Don't worry, I won't be going deep geek into those. So, once you have an idea of where the money's going, and of how that's likely to manifest itself, then with a little background in engineering and the sciences, you have all the puzzle pieces you need to figure out what's next. Got it? You don't. Up to me. Should I extrapolate or pontificate? Oh, never mind. Here's what I think we'll see. I foresee car sensors that would let taxi or Uber drivers charge by weight as well as distance. Consumer drones, or maybe companion apps, that let you identify and store waypoints so they can connect the dots into flight paths so they can fly specific routes or patterns between sets of points you select. Mark the corners of your house and get the drone to record a video survey of your entire gutter line. Find out where it's clogged or record the corners of your property line for a video patrol of damage after a storm. Speaking of the house, I think we'll soon see smarter home garages that can detect the presence of combustible gases and respond in intelligent ways, from controlling garage doors to triggering high-power brushless exhaust fans, whatever it takes to keep things safer. Looking in the garage, I expect to see a new breed of in-dash car consoles that extend smartphone functionality to the dashboard in a way that limits distractions. I think they'll combine navigation with entertainment, weather warnings, traffic alerts, the speed limit where you are right now, how fast you're going with a warning if it's too much over that speed limit, operational car factors like tire inflation or low fuel, automated emergency calls, and who knows what else. Also, I'm pretty sure we'll see garage doors that are built with air pockets between inner and outer panels. It's a little like double-pane windows, adding a measure of insulation without adding more weight or more loading for the garage door opener. Speaking of cars, it doesn't take much tech for a parking garage to know which spaces do or don't have cars in them, and it's pretty easy to detect the speed and position of both incoming cars and exiting cars. I think we'll see something simple, like ceiling-mounted lighted arrows or warnings to guide you to an available parking space without distracting your attention while keeping you aware of exiting or recirculating cars. Not parking in a garage? I think we'll see parking meters that can charge your parking to an EasyPass account. And as long as those meters are gaining a little power and a little networking, they may also gain the ability to know whether a meter has space available. Be nice to hook that into something like Google Maps to help you find a parking space. Those smarter networked meters may also know when somebody parked there without paying the meter. It's a little naughty to think that automation may be able to watch parking meters violating themselves. Speaking of recognition, it would be fairly easy for TV sets to add small cameras and local facial recognition so they can limit the types of content and the amount of viewing time for children per a parent's setting. Speaking of cameras, you may not know this, but digital image sensors naturally detect beyond the visual range into nearby ultraviolet and infrared wavelengths. Cameras add filters to block that extended vision, but without those filters, and with some in-camera intelligence, it would be entirely possible to build an outdoor surveillance camera with the ability to recognize oncoming fires, forest fires, neighboring structure fires, vehicle fires, the end of days, or other fires. We all have smoke and fire detectors indoors, but there's almost nothing to alert you to outdoor fire threats, and it's not all that hard to make that happen. If any of you work around server rooms, you know that they can sound like 1,000 blow dryers all running at once. People do sometimes have to work in those rooms. I'm not sure if all those fans add up to anything the EPA cares about, but it's cheap and easy to do something about it, so I think we'll see attachable, noise-reducing mufflers for the exhaust fans on that rack mount gear. Hardware store time. Brushless motors and power tools are really taking off, delivering more torque per amp hour and, with no brushes to wear out, a very long service life. So I think that can lead to new 10-year power tools, maybe longer. There are a lot of old buildings, houses too, where the floor plans have been lost over time or where there have been so many modifications that the original floor plans don't really show the current layout. We've seen a lot of 3D scanning growth triggered by AR/VR authoring, and before that by CGI effects from movies. I think we'll see gizmos that can make quick, one-stop 3D reads that map structural or architectural or even archaeological spaces, including embedded measurements. I think many drones will get better at reading obstacles on all three axes, so they can avoid collisions even in busy overhead environments that might involve trees or telephone lines, if there are any of those left. And in another segment of the drone universe, I imagine we'll see new classes of drone zeppelins crossing quadcopters with buoyant blimps or dirigibles for carrying larger payloads. Oh, I better not forget things on the home front. I think houses, as well as office spaces, will see new LED fixtures that illuminate brightly without ever showing their naughty bits, meaning those uncomfortably bright little emitter points. I also think we'll see innovations that provide new geometries in LED light casting, tailoring where the illumination goes for applications like kitchen counters, closets, pantries, and workbenches. From lighting to lightning, I think we'll start seeing more homes becoming lightning immune by putting dissipation ahead of conduction in their approach to safeguarding the house. Also, up on the roof, I think we may see force sensors used in ice dam detection, primarily for roofs that are supposed to be conditioned to resist ice dam formation, and there as a way to indicate that the prevention did not work. Staying frosty, I think we'll see refrigerators and freezers that can sound alerts if you don't completely close their doors. And I think we'll see force-sensing snow shovels that can help prevent elders or weaker people from overdoing snow lifts. Indoors, a dog bed with pet chip sensing can alert you when the dog leaves bed before morning, in case that means a cleanup to do. I think we'll see some innovative glass shower walls with both insulated double-pane glass and a hydrophobic coating, so they're much less likely to fog up, much less likely to let water condense on the inside, and much better at containing temperatures both inside and outside the shower. I think we'll see more circuit breaker boxes, or call them distribution panels or load centers, with more ways to provide better house-wide defenses against surges and spikes and other potentially damaging power line events. Well, here are a few predictions on the downside. I think we'll see increasing obsolescence of copper wire-connected landline telephone service, POTS service, which may make a lot of fixed-income people, well, incommunicado. How's grandma? I also think we may see more exurban to rural population areas where you can't get reliable high-speed internet, though 5G and the new 600 megahertz service may step in to help with that. And I'm pretty sure we'll see a continuing and perhaps increasing erosion of the feature set that used to be implicit in Microsoft Outlook, especially when connected to a Microsoft Exchange ActiveSync server. I don't expect this to be the year we'll see a floor-cleaning robot that's smart enough not to roll right over a doggy accident on the floor, ruining both the floor and the robot. I do think, for people with cable modems, uploads will soon be a lot faster than ever, sometimes as fast as downloads. I think we'll see more capable little cameras built into products the size of mobile handsets as mailbox monitors, or even smaller, for toothbrushes. Smart thermostats may start getting smart enough to be smarter about fireplaces. Talking home assistants, you know their names. They'll be more of the same, with small enhancements all the time. But I do anticipate seeing studies, new studies, showing that people who use them are becoming even more sedentary, with resultant health risks, including, just a guess, diabetes. Military cyber warfare defenses across the country are growing. They're consolidating. They're becoming even more formidable. And I expect big leaps there over the next 4 to 5 years, with additional positive fallout benefits to corporate, commercial, and industrial cyber defense measures. I anticipate, though it might not happen in the next year, that home automation devices that can work without cloud or internet connections will start promoting that as being cyber smart, or some other trendy phrase. Let Russia go find a new playground. I think 2019 will be a year when Twitter starts quieting down and Facebook will start acting more grown up. Happy New Year, everybody.
Thank you, Marty. Marty, Why don't you tell me what you got right in 2018? Public service announcements. The following are computer club meetings in the New York, New Jersey, and Connecticut tri-state region. All these meetings are free and open to the public. The computer clubs have random access sessions at each of these club meetings. If you have any questions or need for technical advice, the club members are more than happy to assist. There is no such thing as a dumb question. The Brookdale Computer Users Group will have a presentation on what's new with Chromebooks in 2018. Thursday, December the 27th, meeting time is 7 p.m., and they meet at the Middletown Library Large Meeting Room at 55 New Monmouth Road in Middletown, New Jersey. The Westchester PC User Group will have a presentation on orienteering. It's the world of cartography or mapping. Thursday, January 3rd, and meeting time is 7 p.m. at the Keller Williams Realty, 120 Bloomingdale Road, 1st floor, White Plains, New York. The Amateur Computer Group of New Jersey will meet Friday, January the 4th. Meeting time is 8 p.m., and they meet at the Scotch Plains Rescue Squad in Scotch Plains, New Jersey. The New York Amateur Computer Club has its meeting Thursday, January the 10th. Meeting time is 7 p.m. They meet at NYU, 32 Waverly Place, also known as the Silver Building, room 411 in Manhattan, New York. The Long Island Macintosh Users Group will meet Friday, January the 11th. Meeting time is 7 p.m., and they meet at the Harry J. Scherr Hall at the New York Institute of Technology, Old Westbury Campus in Old Westbury, New York. WBAI has, for various reasons, not been able to be financially self-supporting. It has to broaden to a larger listening audience to continue operation. The management has decided to do a major overhaul of the program schedule. Listeners and viewers are increasingly using the internet to receive their media content on demand instead of being tethered to a fixed schedule. WBAI has revamped the program schedule to begin January the 7th, 2019. The Personal Computer Show is not part of that mix. Although we will not be part of the new program schedule, the Personal Computer Show will continue to be available on the internet. The Personal Computer Show was originated on WBAI in the early 1980s in response to the birth of personal computing. The program's success was it did not depend on any corporate funding or support. Our bias was in the best interest of you, the consumer. We were able to give our honest opinions and views without reprisal. We thank you, the listeners, for all your support, and we will continue with you in an expanded venue. We can be heard each Wednesday at 6 p.m. Eastern Time on PRN.FM, on the Internet. Podcasts are available from all major pod hosting sites, as well as our website and PCRadioShow.org. If you have any questions for us or commentary on any of our feature segments, just send us your email address with your telephone number, in which we can call you at a convenient hour. There is no such thing as a stupid question. If you have any questions for us, just send us an email addressed to hank at pcradioshow.org. For over 35 years, we were a call-in talkback show. Your feedback enabled us to be in tune and relevant with the changes in technology. WBAI has not had telephone service in the studio for the past 3 years, and this has constrained the program from engaging the listening audience. Although WBAI will return to a more normal operation soon, it is controlling the program distribution onto other media formats. With the changes, we will return to our roots. The potential listening audience on the internet is quite broad, and with the ability to control our format and distribution, we will better serve you. Although we are parting company with WBAI, Joe King and I have had a great association on WBAI. We ask you to continue to support the station in its new format. We are not ending the show, just the over-air broadcast. In the meantime, stay in touch and keep on computing and remember to back up. I'm Hank Key, and on behalf of Joe King and Michael Horowitz, Dr. Alfred Poor and Marty Winston, we thank you for listening. We wish everyone to stay safe and have a happy new year. And until we meet again to sign off, same time, same station next week.